so many physicists, and all speakers, and now talks with slides here. Now we have the first talk with slides, and it's my pleasure to introduce all to this session. This is a talk by Spiridonov from Duma and and he'll tell us about event spaces and their associated electric general problems.
Yes, the general problems. The title is a little unfortunate, so after hearing today's talks and many speakers referring to indices, the appropriate title would be elliptic hypergeometric function and superconformal indices, or four-dimensional elliptic genera, if you wish. But I gave so many talks with such titles, so I really hesitate to give one more. And I would like to add some new stuff, rather recent, related to land space. But still, I will be giving more details about the introductory thing, because I'm sure that these things are new for most of the people present in the audience. And at the end, we'll say what land space is doing in the business as well, and what's new with is associated with that. So, what are elliptic hypergeometric functions? This is a new class of special functions which appeared rather recently, say 20 years ago, it's top level special functions, so hypergeometric type, and absorbed all previously types of special of hypergeometric functions, and they are defined only with the help of integral representations. If you try to define them using the series representations, it doesn't work because infinite series of such type do not converge, and mathematically they do not define functions appropriately. And you have to deal with the integral representations only to have really transcendental special functions. And that's exactly elliptic hypergeometric integrals. So integrals means general type of functions. And the definition I came up after 3 years working in this field is the following. So you take, say, univariate setting, and you take integral contour integral for some axis phi contour, for some meromorphic function rho, and say the measure on the unit torus, and you demand that the kernel of this integral must be a solution of the linear first of the difference equations, not the difference equation, more precisely the Q difference equation of the first order with a coefficient h, which is an arbitrary elliptic function. In the multiplicative sense, it means that there is some moduli phi, this is standard moduli of the curve, and this function must be invariant under this change of the argument. This is by definition the elliptic function. Also some people say p-elliptic, because explicit reference to the modulus p. So you take first of the q difference equation, one scale q, and this is another scale, p. And the solution of this equation must be kernel of my integral, and then by definition this is elliptic hypergeometric integral. Very simple definition. And that's it. Actually, this is enough to build the whole theory. Why? Because there is a very nice theorem going back to Abel and Jacobi, which says that the structure, what is the structure of general elliptic function? It's the following one. It can be represented as a ratio of products of theta functions. This small theta, theta of z of p, is the by definition in this notation, is just the double infinite product. So here is the definition of the standard infinite product. You take modulus p less than 1 and build such a geometric progression infinite product, so it converges for arbitrary z. And so this is a well-known thing. And you take two of them, this one and this, and this is the theta function. And in relation to the standard Jacobi theta function, it's very simple. This is a theta series of some particular type, theta 3 I agree. Everybody knows that. So I divide it by some particular infinite product, and this is by definition what I'm working with. And if you put it here, it's the famous Jacobi theorem, the triple product identity for theta functions. Well known thing. So, you know the structure of the coefficient in this equation, which is given by the block type. And here is non-trivial constraint on the divisor points of this function, because tk, wk are the complex numbers, but they must satisfy this condition in order to for this function to be elliptic. And then when you multiply z by p, you get some quasi-periodic factors, well known from the theory of theta functions, and they cancel out exactly because of this condition. So the setting is defined very well. Now you have to solve this equation.
I'm sorry, what is q?
Q, arbitrary complex number. P is modulus for this to be well defined in this setting, in this case.
And your I is just a number.
I what I?
And the first integral, the first I critical I. The integral.
Ah, this is a normal integral. It's first ever integral. What I didn't say is that. So you no that's this is an integral, right? This is integral.
No, I mean it doesn't depend on any other variable.
It's defined like this. As soon as you specify this function, it depends on the order of elliptic functions. So first integer enters the business. This is called the order elliptic functions, the number of zeros or poles in the fundamental parallelogram appears. Then you have a quite rich set of variables, tk and wk, which enter as the parameters of this integral. So I started from no parameters. As soon as I made everything explicit, I have a discrete parameter, and so it defines the moduli space if you wish of this function. Okay, now I said everything. What's next? Now I have to be able to solve this equation. Here it is. This, if I will be able to solve this equation for some function gamma with one theta function as a coefficient, then evidently, because of the factorization, I immediately will solve the initial equation. It's just a matter of changing the variables of the solution of this equation. And the particular solution which I will be working with is called the elliptic gamma function. And it has absolutely explicit form. It's double infinite product over two geometric progressions, p and q, in the numerator and the denominator. To solve it, it's absolutely easy. Just take this infinite product and the downstairs. And look for the equation. You multiply this guy by q, which means that you shift k by 1. So it starts not from 0, but from 1. And you divide it by gamma. It means that you cancel everything except exactly the case k goes to 0. And this gives me the first infinite product. So, with this denominator function, I immediately solve this equation, initial equation, with this piece. So I solve this equation with this piece. And it's very easy to check that this guy works for this part. So this is the solution. It's one line exercise in very simple algebra analysis, whatever. But, pay attention. Here q modulus less than 1, and here q was arbitrary complex number. So it's a particular solution, it's not a general one. Some special one which emerged in this particular constraint, the domain of values of the parameters. Next. So as soon as you have this elliptic gamma function, you immediately come up with this explicit expression for your elliptic hypergeometric integral in the univariate setting. So this is the most general elliptic hypergeometric function in the univariate setting. And it absorbs all previously known hypergeometric functions. Gauss hypergeometric function, its particular specialization, Q analogs of that, and many others. So it absorbs everything. But it's too general at this point. Too many parameters, no additional structural elements, so you have to specify that to be able to work further. Okay, let's go a little bit about these properties of the gamma function, because they will be crucial in the following. First, remember, Q and P were entering very in a non-symmetric way. But here is the symmetry. The solution of this equation is symmetric in the moduli parameters. And what does it mean? It means that there is a second equation. If you scale Z by P, you pick up another theta function now, but with moduli parameter Q.
So P, Q are totally independent.
Totally independent, yes. You see, you have second equation of the same type as before. And this is theta function with calculated independent modular t parameter, and here is the result. So you start from something which you did not get. This was not inside of the definition at the beginning, but actually you work with two independent elliptic curves. That's this is the very important point in this business. You start not from one elliptic curve, but you immediately come to the two elliptic curves, and moreover they are symmetric in some setting, in this function setting. And you see this function, which is the hypergeometric integral, is also symmetric in P and Q. So it's a symmetry of the whole object. Okay, some properties which are useful. This is an inversion formula. Whenever I have many arguments in the gamma function, actually means the product of gamma functions and Z, PQ divided by Z is 1. It's a very easy exercise to see that the all different products cancel and you have an inversion formula. This limiting relation is very useful when you deal with residue calculus associated with meromorphic functions. This is important, you will see on the next slide. This is a well-known, this is the doubling of the
gamma function argument square is given by the product of eight elliptic gamma functions, which for each sign and for each argument. So eight elliptic gamma functions multiplied give me this gamma z square. Reductions. Reductions are as follows. If you take p goes to zero in a smart way, you come to the q gamma function, which is lower level, and if you take q goes to one from below, then you get Euler gamma function, and that's how it reproduces all these q gamma geometric functions and the plane hypergeometric functions. It's a hierarchy. There are more complicated degeneration limits, I won't talk about that, but they give different type of q hypergeometric functions. Okay, let's keep that. It's a separate story. What is the next property of this elliptic gamma function? This workshop is called arithmetics, geometry, automorphic forms, and physics. So I started from analysis. Now I come to the automorphic stuff. So let me introduce three complex variables, the modulized parameters of my function, of the elliptic gamma function, and parameterize my p and q in this way. So omega 3 divided by omega 2, omega 1 divided by omega 3. So I will need the third, which is omega 3 divided by omega 1. This is, as you understand, not independent of the first. And also I need this modular transform parameter. So I simply flip and change the sign. So tildes means modular transformations of these variables. And the equation which I started from was given in the multiplicative notation, but in the additive notation, it can be written in the following way. So the equation for elliptic gamma function has the following form if I now use these omega variables. Shift by omega 1 gives me theta function with this particular parameterization of the argument of this theta function. It's the same equation, just written in the different notation. And at this point, I should mention again the definition of the integrals themselves. So the kernels of those integrals are solutions of the finite difference equations with this shifting variable omega 1 when the h function is real double periodic paramorphic function. So those who don't know multiplicative notation, at this point you should recognize maybe that the function h which I was describing at the beginning is actually double periodic paramorphic, so Russian function on the torus. Okay, that's the equation. And we know already that if I restrict to this particular region of gamma, then this particular solution is given like this function. And general solution, as you know, is given in a very simple way. You just multiply this particular solution by arbitrary function, which is periodic with the period omega 1. And that's the general solution. But it is quite rich, and it can be used for next step in the story. So this function, it satisfies two more the finite difference equations. First one is the periodicity in omega 2, because this argument is periodic in omega 2. What does it mean? It means that I work with the solution of this equation, which are meromorphic in this variable. Not only in u, but in exponential of u, it's different analogicity property. Which means that I can expand this function into Fourier series and work with the Fourier expansions. So second and third equation is, of course, uses the shift by the third omega 3 variable, and as I described already, you pick up another theta function with different modular parameters. So, as these three equations they define this gamma function, you need to have the multiplication by constant. So, uniqueness is somehow fixed if you fix these three equations. But these two equations are auxiliary. I need only this one according to the initial definition and many, many things which will be used in the following. So, what I will do? I will do the following. I will use this freedom in multiplication of that particular solution by a periodic function, and I choose this periodic function, which is omega 1 periodic, another elliptic gamma function. One original one solution, and I multiply by this very particular, the same function with different parameterization of base parameters, so pq, here's q tilde r, some r here, and some argument in this way. And this is this, another elliptic gamma function, because it's first of all, it solves again the same equation as before, but now it satisfies, of course, two different equations, not those which I just described, but different three equations will work. Here they are. When I shift by omega 2, now instead of pure periodicity, I pick up now the theta function, this r, third base variable, which I have. So third elliptic curve were also intertwined. And actually, instead of the SL2z group of acting in the standard way, you have here SL3z. And that's why we have so many base parameters all the time, elliptic curves, but they appear one by one touch, tile to each other. So second equation. And the third equation is this one. When you see by omega 3, you get the ratio of theta of q and theta of q tilde. So this is what? This is the modulus transformation of theta function. And here is the law of the modulus transformation of SL2z. Modulus transformation of theta functions, which is quite unusual to most of you, I'm sure, because you are not used to such a form, because I use short theta function. And you see what I have as a quasi-periodicity factor. I have exponential of the object, which is called Bernoulli polynomial. It's second order Bernoulli polynomial, multiple Bernoulli polynomials, diagonal of the second order, and that's the textbook object function, relation. But this, you will not find textbook where it's written in this way. But this is very correct, very convenient way and very smart, because this Bernoulli polynomials is also central objects in this story. Okay, so here it is. So essentially what you have here, exponential minus pi I b to 2. So exponential of polynomial is second order. That's the third equation. And now, as I said, you three equations fix your function uniquely. And here is the SL3z transformation, which in comes into the story, is the following. You have the second representation for the same function. So I start from the multiplication of two elliptic gamma functions, but it can be written as the one elliptic gamma function, which is again now different type of modulus parameters, times exponential of Bernoulli polynomial of the third order, which has the following form. It's cubic polynomial, symmetric, anti-symmetric, with respect to this argument. So, this relation, that this equals to the first previous slide definition, is exactly one of the SL3z group transformation laws, which were considered by Ferdinand Marchenka. So they explained that this elliptic gamma function is nothing else than the automorphic form of degree 1, as they called it, abelian set. The integrals, which I have been finding, which I will describe later on, they are actually, it's work in progress, but I can say that they are, in a sense, realized the non-abelian version of these automorphic forms. So this is a new type of automorphism that emerges here, and the story is in the process of unfolding. And here is the definition of these multiple Bernoulli polynomials. It's a multivariable extension of the standard Bernoulli polynomial setting, and it was introduced by Barnes in the 20th century. Okay, that's explanation why automorphic forms and theory of the forms is relevant to this business. Next, I will not use this story, I just mentioned it for you to know. The cornerstone of the theory of this transcendental elliptic hypergeometric functions is this relation, this identity. It's called elliptic bis integral, so it's my old result now. And it starts from this thing, and it's very fundamentally important. What is here? So I have some infinite products. Now you know what is that. This is some just multiplicative factor. So integral over unit circle. Here I specify now the integration contour. And here I have 12 elliptic gamma functions in the numerator. So six parameters tj. And satisfying this constraint, this is precisely the same constraint as before, just in particular notations. Why? Because I have used the doubling of the gamma function argument. So I choose in special way these those arguments wk, that I have now this definition formula and the denominator of my numerator and denominator take this specific form. And though that constraint, or ellipticity constraint, that we leave on the elliptic curve is reduced now to this relation. And so I demand that the module is less than one, that very nice separation of poles with this contour. And suddenly this integral is computable exactly. You get the estimation or evaluation of this integral in terms of the, exactly the same function that enter the kernel. So that's the definition of exact integrals thing. And so you do not change the class of functions. That's it. You see here triangle product over the parameters tj. Why this is a unique relation? Why it's so fundamental? First, Newton was mentioned already in this conference, let me mention him again. It's a top level at the moment realization of the binomial theorem. So the whole combinatorial theory hidden in the binomial theorem, up to Q binomial and so on, it's hidden here. It's here, just a point of reduction. Another point, the famous Euler P integral, the very simple but very fundamental also relation, we're having enormous number of applications, in particular with theory of plane hypergeometric functions. It also lies at the bottom of this relation, and that's essentially why I call it the beta integral, because this is a beta function or beta integral in the standard theory of hypergeometric functions.
But this integral doesn't have branch cuts, right? I mean, how the
branch cuts where? Here?
No, no, in the first integral you have only poles. How is it possible that?
It's possible. You just accumulate poles near these branch cuts. So when you take particular limit, p goes to 0, q goes to 1, you will see that poles start to accumulate and form branching cuts. Mm-hmm. It's well defined analytical procedure. So that's essential remark in the sense that these are meromorphic functions.
Yeah.
But reduced things are branch cuts not that well defined analytically.
And it's much better.
And it's general story behind the finite difference equations. When you work with non-differential but finite difference equations, the analytic properties of your objects are better. Okay, what next? This is the germ for the whole story about these transcendental and elliptic hypergeometric functions. I will say more. For another important one, this is the measure for the most general kind of special functions of hypergeometric type which satisfy orthogonality properties. So it's an orthogonality measure, let's say bi-orthogonality measure. So there is a very nice set of bi-orthogonal functions which are bi-orthogonal with respect to this measure. So it's a member also of this spectral theory as well. I will say a little more about this as a survey. There is some hidden E6 root system symmetry hidden in this identity. I won't talk about that. A little later I will talk about E7. And using this exact formula, I define a kind of elliptic analog of Fourier transformation. I call it Bayer-Lehmann, but that's another name of this thing. But essentially, it's an integral transformation which can be defined using exactly that formula. And with the help of that, you can define the realization of the Coxeter relations. So you can work with Coxeter relations at infinite dimensional spaces and realize them with the help of integral operators. And this integral transform exactly does it. So you can realize Coxeter relation for a permutation group using this elliptic Fourier transform, which is based on that identity. And in mathematical physics, this identity is known as a star triangle relation, so it works for building general solutions of the Young-Baxter equation, general in the sense that you work in the infinite dimensional spaces, infinite dimensional solutions, principal series representations, and they are defined, the R matrices are operators, here are integral operators. And again, this identity works as a germ for building all that. Next step of generalization of these objects is the elliptic analog of the Euler-Gauss hypergeometric function. It works as follows. Instead of 6, you now have 8 parameters. So you change the boundary.
But the maximal symmetry group in the previous construction, this is a wide group of E6.
E6, yes. Here it becomes E7, and so it's much easier to describe. So balancing condition, elliptic constraint now takes this form, probably say. If you take this constraint because of the inversion relation for elliptic gamma function, you immediately reduce this function to down to the elliptic beta integral, so it becomes computable explicitly, but in general it is not. And here is the explicit E7 symmetry, which is realized by a group. So the same is this function equals to itself with the change of variables in the following way. So first for we multiply by f, next for divide, where f is square root of this guy. Times the first 4, and it has some non-trivial multiplication of the factor which is described here. So remember, this is the product of the gamma functions because arguments are different. And the fact that this E7 is very easy to see, you just write that Tj equals to pq over 1/4 exponential 2 pi I xj, and balancing condition this becomes immediately sum of xj equals to 0, and if you rewrite this law, you have an xj times xj minus 1/2 sum xj from 1 to 4. And this is precisely the key extension of the A7 root system to E7 root system, addition of this root, and you add essentially a reflection with respect to this.
So you're coming to E7 from A7.
Yeah, A7 is there immediately because it's symmetric in parameters. But this is highly non-trivial and hidden, of course. But in general, so function, this function has no trivial transformation with respect to this EWSM symmetry. You can normalize it in such a way that it will invariant. So essentially, you deal with the invariance of WSM. Next thing, which of course one must ask about this elliptic hypergeometric things, is the elliptic analog of the hypergeometric equation. And it goes as follows. You have addition law for theta functions. Here I have four theta functions, the protocol four. For each sum, I have a separate theta function. Four theta functions plus four theta functions plus four theta functions equals to zero. Well known, some people call it ring modulation, but it's addition law for theta functions. And this identity can be written in the following way, where V is now this integral. This is called contiguous relation. So you scale one of the parameters, divide by particular combination of theta functions associated with this equation, and that's an easy to derive identity.
But here theta function with four parameters, yes?
No, he, protocol of four theta functions. So each sign means that I think it's
T7, T6, T8.
Four parameters. Ah, yes, of course. This additional formula was four abelian variables. I just wrote them in a particular way to show that immediately. This, from this you get this, just because this equation is explained by the kernel of this B, you just integrate that identity and you get relation for integral. Essentially that's all, because now what you do, you use the W7 symmetry, you multiply the number of these equations, you build full W7 orbit. You plug in all the identities for this big function generated by that initial relation, you get many contiguous relations. And one of the contiguous relations is exactly the this relation, this elliptic hypergeometric equation, it's diagonal, it's acting in one direction in this sense. Because of the balancing condition, the product of all t's is constant. Therefore, when I shift in this way, essentially I make diagonal shift. And so, coefficient times this, coefficient times this plus this function is just the original one b divided by some particular combination. So two elliptic functions. And this a function, which I just said, the following elliptic, standard elliptic function. So it's invariant with respect to shifts by p of all arguments. You can shift any of them, but in this way, the balancing condition must be preserved, and it is invariant. And that's an important property, and this is now, you can rewrite it in a more compact form. Okay, I skip the notations, how I change the variables. Here it's more, another form. Now you see I do it in such notations that my SK variables now have SA, the variance symmetry needed, it's symmetric. And this A function now it has a very compact form. And this constant which emerges here is also part of the six theta functions. And I made diagonal, I changed variable in such a way that that previous shift became just multiplication by Q of some particular separate variables which were parameterized. Okay, probably I should show what I did. I did the following. I denote T6 C, X, T7, C divided by X. Therefore, when I scale Q, these two variables in this way, as here, it's essentially multiplication of X by Q or Q inverse. And here it is. Don't try to remember details, just remember the structure. The structure is following. You have second order Q difference equation. So it's Q here, Q inverse Q, so it's second order. Because we have also diagonal terms, with elliptic function coefficients, which you know solutions explicitly as integral representations. So at the moment, this is the more general exactly solvable equation, and so top solvable equation, because we have closed form expression for the solution. This is one solution, but it's very easy to build a full set of solutions, because we just apply symmetries of the equations, which are not symmetries of the solution. There are many symmetries of this equation, which are not solutions, symmetries of this particular solution which I started from. Therefore, if I apply those transformations to this function, I will get the another solution, actually a full set of solutions. So this is a completely solvable case. So what about applications? First application emerged, so a theory of completely integral systems, namely in the theory of Calogero-Moser type of models, and some generalized Roussinas type model, which is a relativistic extension of that. And there, these functions, in very special cases, work as the eigenfunctions or normalizations of eigenfunctions. So it's a spectral problem type of application. More important, completely unexpected from my side, is the following story, is the indices story. It appears that these functions which I described to you, they are identical 100%, coincide with the so-called superconform indices in four-dimensional supersymmetric field theories. And the identity which I described, for instance, this W7 identity, it's proof of the Zeiger duality for those four-dimensional quantum field theories. Proof in the particular topological sector, namely in the sector of BPS states. So in those rich field theories, there is a subspace of these BPS states, and these states, the structure of this space of states must be the same in electric and magnetic theories, dual theories, mirror symmetry. In a sense, this is a kind of four-dimensional work of the mirror symmetry, so you have two theories which are related to this by electromagnetic duality, and the topological sector, the set of BPS states, might be the same in both. And those identities prove exactly this statement. And they prove it in mathematical reduction as theorems. That's very important and completely unexpected to me application in the superconform indices. So the same things are related to exciton partition functions, which were considered by Nekrasov, and there is a beautiful conjecture by Gayot and Hetchul Kim, and we have here, and we are very glad to host Hetchul Kim, which connects this the same story behind this with the exciton partition functions. It's conjectural, but very important open problem in these reasons. And also the same things as soon as I mentioned Jan Baxter, it means that there are some new solo two-dimensional models of statistical mechanics. And here is the, I'd like to give you this table. This is the table of classical special functions. And it starts from the Jacobi polynomials, or 2F1, these are special polynomial cases of this Gauss hypergeometric function. It's called Jacobi orthogonal polynomial. So there is a very nice theory behind that, classical, all the textbooks, many textbooks contain that. And here is the top, on the right corner. And here is the plane hypergeometric line, so you change the number of indices. And at this level you have 6J symbols by Rocca, for instance, or Wilson polynomials. And these are now not polynomials anymore, these are by orthogonal functions. If you have Q deform these things, then it goes some Q hypergeometric set of orthogonal polynomials. This is a fundamental thing, asking Wilson polynomials, because this is the more general set of orthogonal polynomials. So the, of classical type, so they have the same properties as the Jacobi polynomials, but now this is top. All the below is now not a polynomial, it's bioptogonal. This is 10^9 working with the, so it absorbs everything. And here, this is Q hypergeometric function of special type. What's this? This is the Q hypergeometric series 10^9, which is the same as here, times modulo transformed. So prime means modulo transformation of Q, which is hidden here. And this is some case of the that V function which I defined. And this is elliptic level now. So what does it mean, these indices? These indices mean exactly that there is some hidden elliptic function which has 12 zero points on the fundamental parallelogram of periods. And this is the hypergeometric series which I didn't define. It can be defined as particular sequence of the... So your integral has poles. You pick up some particular set of poles and sum up the residues of these poles. You just change the contour and pick up this particular set, and that's it. This is the this particular sum of residues. It's a hypergeometric series, and it terminates. It must terminate, as I said. You cannot define the non-terminating series in this way. And there is the top again. You have 12^11 times its modulo transform, and these functions are orthogonal with respect to that elliptic integral measure. So that's essentially the one-minute flash of the theory of orthogonal functions, which are hidden behind this relation. And now I jump.
I have a question.
Okay.
Can you show the picture again?
Okay.
There's something called Nasrallah-Rahman integral and Branges-Wilson integral. Where are they in this picture?
So I call it not Nasrallah-Rahman integral, but Rahman integral, because Rahman was the first to identify it.
The same.
And but Nasrallah-Rahman is a little different. Identified was by Rahman. It's a special p goes to zero limit of that my integral which I described before. The Branges is, I believe, at this level.
Branges and Wilson.
It's here. It's a measure for these functions, yes. And Rahman integral is here. And at this level, you have now a little bit integral. And
so you have some extension of this Rahman?
Yes, it's more elliptic next level. It's because you have additional Bayesian parameter, and instead of Q gamma functions, you work with elliptic gamma functions. And it's much more symmetric, and it has different limits, and so it's more richer. Okay, what are superconform indices? Probably this is the most interesting to some of you. So you start from four-dimensional supersymmetric field theory with n equal one supersymmetry, so there is no trivial normalization group bubble. And this is the superconformal group, which has generated SU2 subgroups. These are super translations. This has special superconformal transformation generated. These are dilations. And this is special U1 group hidden inside that group, which is called R charges group. So you, all these generators generate this group, and just to show you, here are the full set of commutation relations of this algebra for that particular definition combination of this generator. So it's, this means actual super bracket. And I just showed that it's you start from real four-dimensional supersymmetric field theory. Now kill this supersymmetry. You pick up one particular supercharge, you say Q bar 1 and S bar 1. So it's between special superconformal charge and supercharge. And then they satisfy this relation. Anti-commutator is to H curve, which is a particular combination of these generators of this group. And they are nilpotent, of course, because they are supercharges in this diagram. And then you compute this object. This is trace over a full Hilbert space of your quantum field theory with this Z2 grading thing. This is called fermionic number, but this is nothing else than Z2 grading hidden inside your theory because it's supersymmetric. And these are exponentials of a full set of commuting generators. So you use a maximal Cartan subalgebra. That's what you want to dig out from the algebra. Maximal Cartan algebra, which commutes subalgebra, which commutes with this Q diagram, which is particularly chosen. And this, there are the following generators. This Q root AR, which is H minus RT. This J3, which is just because you broke the symmetry. So for each of these generators, you put a special fugacity, so exponential. It's just a particular special combination because this PQ will be precisely those PQ as before. These fugacities are for flavor groups, so some external global symmetry groups. And this is trivial innocence factor because of the supersymmetry, because of the Z2 grading, the eigenvalues of this, the non-zero eigenvalue states of the eigenstates of this curve H do not contribute. It's a property of supersymmetry. Because of this presence of this, only the states which satisfy this condition, zero modes of this curvature, contribute, or simply speaking, cohomology space. You have to find cohomology space of this setting. And only they, these are the PS states precisely, they contribute to this index, and that's exactly why it is index. And so you compute it, and this is needed to the heuristic methods, not trivial.
Yes, okay, system.
And here is the final answer. You know, instead of this huge trace width, what meaning is huge, this path integral of four-dimensional quantum field theory. But in the end, you get the final integral over the Haar measure of your gauge group G, which was involved inside the definition of your quantum field theory. So this is the Haar measure. And so exponential of this type, where a function in is the so-called single particle states index, and it has the following explicit form. So some particular combinations of this P and Q emerge. These are R charges of the chiral fields. This is sum over chiral fields. So chiral fields, they transform with respect to flavor group and with respect to G gauge group. So these are characters of the representations involved in the definitions of all these fields, and they depend on the fugacities, which are flavor group fugacities and gauge group fugacities. And this is the conjugated term, these are conjugated representations, some conjugation. And this piece is the contribution of the gauge field, so connection. So, and your 5-1 connection, your gauge fields must always be in the adjoint representation of the gauge groups. Therefore, the character of the adjoint representation emerges through this special coefficient. And so, this is a completely now well-defined mathematical object. And you can work with that using rigorous mathematical methods. And I'm telling you that this is exactly the another definition of elliptic geometric integrals. So a particular set of elliptic geometric integrals.
For which G?
For basically for all, which is quite interesting from many points of view. Basically for all.
Well, you define just one. Right?
I will say one example. Mm-hmm. For instance, if you compute this superconformal index for chiral superfield with the flavor group of U1 charge, U1 group, some external U1 group, then this index is computed using the formula in this way. This is precisely the elliptic gamma function. So the elliptic gamma function has the meaning of the index, superconformal index of the chiral superfield in four dimensions. Now let's take, for instance, for SUN group, this is the definition, because all the integrals depend on the maximum torus variables of the groups, the scalar measure is reduced to the product of one Hermann determinants of explicitly well-known thing. Here is the elliptic bit integral hidden in this story. It's we take SU2 group. Here is the contour of the joint representation for this SU2 group and flavor group SU6. And then you take this another set of representations which are fundamental with respect to both SU2 and SU6. These things here are the characters, and arc charges are fixed in this way. These particular fractional numbers. It's some separate logic is used to fix them. And here are characters of this velocity elements of fundamental group is this, under fundamental this, and this is the product. This will be exactly, this is the condition that you work with the unitary group SU6. And this is exactly the elliptic condition, this balancing condition, which just in different notations. Exactly, in these notations.
Why not SU4,
for example? You can do it. I just want to give the simplest example. Basically, all field theories which are considered in the literature have this interpretation, and we have found even more substantial new models of that type. So it's a matter of gain, in a sense. But this is just a particular example which leads to the elliptic bit integral. So here is the relation between these y variables and those tk variables which I described before. And using that data, you plug into that formula, and you will come to the left-hand side of the elliptic bit integral. So that is the superconformal index of this particular field theory, which was considered by Zyberg in 1994. And the right-hand side, it's another story. It's a different field theory. It's now no gauge groups, no these fiber bundles. It's trivial. It's again G equals to 1, so it's trivial. But the flavor group is the same as SU6. You have one field, which is anti-fundamental representation of the SU6 group. You have the character, you have the arc charge. You plug in this data into that formula, and you will come up to the right-hand side of the elliptic bit integral evaluation formula. And what does it mean, the equality, the theorem? The theorem means that the set of BPS states in these two theories coincide. And this duality was discovered by Zyberg in 1994. He exactly used this model to say that confinement is reachable in symmetric field theories, because this is confinement phenomenon. The dual theory, which is the strongly coupled regime, it's a field of Vesuvian type with free chiral fields, and so no gauge degrees of freedom are present, and so this is essentially the elliptic bit integral is describing the confinement phenomenon, it's the indicator of the confinement phenomenon. And the connection between these Zyberg results and the theorem I described has been found by Dolan and Nosler. I forgot to mention that the superconformal indices themselves were introduced by two groups. One is Romansberger, and another is a group led by Maldacena. It's Kini, Minvalla, Maldacena, and Raju. So these two groups introduced the notion of superconformal indices in 1995, year after 2005. I'm sorry, in 2005. So it was essentially 5 years later than the theory of elliptic geometric functions has been launched.
To which integral identity this equivalence is related?
This equivalence is. Okay, let me show it to you. It's this identity. This is the superconformal of the interacting theory. This is the superconformal of free theory in the infrared.
Is this identity generalization of this Nostrala-Rahman?
Yes, T goes to zero. It's a generalization of Rahman. I really prefer to call
it Rahman. And for Rahman, it's SU5 or what?
It's broken. You have to break the symmetry quite strongly, because the permutation symmetry will be broken and some other relations will be broken. And because you kill the symmetry, and the elliptic level is the most symmetric relation. Okay, let's go further. Yes?
In this formula, the integration, the meaning of Z is what?
Z is the maximum torus variable for the gauge group. Sorry. It's the eigenvalue of the SU2, for instance, if you wish. If you take.
In all cases, when you have a confinement, that means that the right hand side has no integral.
Yes, yes. And the symmetry which I described for the kernel of the earlier Gauss function, which is when you do not have evaluation, you have a symmetry relation between two integrals. Mm-hmm. That's the Zyberg duality for SU2 gauge group, but now SU8 for your rule. So you add two more chiral fields, mm-hmm. and then your duality becomes really non-trivial. Your two theories both are interacting,
mm-hmm.
yeah. and they agree in the fixed infrared points.
And you use the word confinement because there are no gauge fields, or
that's exactly that's exactly why it's called confinement, because there are no gauge fields of freedom.
Okay.
Now we jump to geometry. So geometry, where is geometry? The point is that although I gave you the flat space superconformal algebra, actually when you look for how the physicists compute the things, you will see that they actually work not with the flat R4, but they do so-called radial quantization. They compactify this R3 to the S3 space, and even compactify the time variable to the S1. So essentially they work with the S3 times S1, which is the same as the Hopf surface. So essentially you have these two complex variables which are identified in this way using some contracting transformation, and this is known as the Hopf surface. So essentially what you do, you compute this superconformal, and this is on the Hopf surface. Your field theories are defined on the Hopf surface. And these people, Asen, Kasani and others, they have computed this path integral which defines this essentially the same index using the localization theorem, and they have found that again the same formula for this index and superconformal index, and they were working precisely with the geometry of Hopf surface. So that's geometry is here in the following. The function I described, the superconformal index I described, everything is attached to four-dimensional quantum field theories on the Hopf surface. And next step is exactly to change the topology of this Hopf surface. You replace S3 by length space. And length space goes as follows. So it's defined by a set of integers. You start from some integer to positive integer. Then you look for the definition of the S3 space in the complex representation. Then you identify the points of this S3 space, of this manifold, identify with the help of roots of unity, or arc roots of unity. So here are K1, K2 involved, but essentially it depends on the difference of this K1 and KT. Essentially, you have two integers, R and another one, which is combination of K1 and K2. And that's how length space is defined. Unfortunately, that even until now, the general length space was not treated. What was treated is the case when you have this k1, 1 and minus 1. So essentially, you fix that additional integer to be some particular number, and so people consider it the superconformal indices on this space, and came up with the following objects. Now, how it deforms is the passage to the length space. Instead of the standard elliptic gamma function, you have this rather strange combination of two elliptic gamma functions. Three bases now emerge, P in the R, Q in the R, P, Q. And they enter as moduli parameters of this standard
elliptic gamma function. The Q are the parameters of the Hopf surface.
Yes, Hopf surface parameters. In particular, P and Q are moduli spaces of the Hopf surface. There is lensing. Lensing is here. So this is additional degree of freedom, it's integer, say modulo R. And this is exactly, it deals with the non-contractible surface cycles on the length space. So S3, there are no non-contractible cycles, and here they are, and this additional variable displays the same role as Z. So it's additional degree of freedom which enters the game. And so you have two now, one continuous, one discrete. And that's what emerges. Okay. So no time to say who we did what, because but it's mentioned in this
slide. Is this still the case when you're on the special length space?
Yes, it's special length space. You fix one integer in a very particular way, as I described. You see 1 and minus 1 in this general definition. That's what has been computed. This object emerged. So, probably, how much time I left?
5 minutes, a little bit more.
Okay, then I will slash this part in the following. So I skip the properties of this combination of elliptic gamma functions. When it emerged, it looked like it completely somewhat new object. So that it looks like as if it is, it brings some new type of elliptic hypergeometric functions. And especially, I would like to mention the work of Kells, who has found first identity, Riggles has found first identity using this type of elliptic gamma functions. And I followed his work exactly with the purpose to recognize what kind of objects these are, how different they are from the theory of standard Elliptic hypergeometric functions, which I described you. And I will jump to the following statement. First thing I found is that actually it's a combination of elliptic gamma functions of particular type. So it's not far, it's actually the subspace of the elliptic hypergeometric functions, but I call them rarefied. Why rarefied? Because this rather strange combination of those different base elliptic gamma functions, that can be actually is the particular product of standard elliptic gamma functions with the basis P in the power R and Q in the power R. We just took a very special combination of arguments, and when you multiply them, there is a rather simple proof. I will skip it. It uses the so-called elliptic gamma function of the second order, that believe me. But this is equal to this. So essentially, this is the protocol standard elliptic gamma functions with the basis replaced by R's power of sole basis. And this is very important, because if you look for the main theorem, which is the, again, the germ for everything, it goes as follows. Now this gamma with the index R is that particular combination, here I should say. So it is convenient to do the following. You define this very particular combination of this small gamma with this multiplicative parameter. Variables. This is multiplication by some particular, it's simple, cumbersome, but simple factor, normalization factor. It comes from the fact that for gamma 1, when r is equal to 1, you get not exactly the elliptic gamma function, which must be there because r equals 1 is under S3 sphere, but up to some multiplication. And this is exactly, you divide by that, and then you define this gamma rb. And the idea is that if you replace all standard elliptic gamma functions by this elliptic gamma function and integrate over z and sum over m, then that's the, you get new identities. And here is the confirmation. Here is the kernel of the this rarefied analog of this elliptic beta integral. Again, six parameter continuous parameters, but now you have six additional discrete variables entering the arguments. And just to mention this, we will show you again this gamma R. So continuous variable is here and here. And discrete variables merge in the exponentials of E modulo space and here. In very particular way, there is no symmetry. So integers and continuous variables enter independently. And here, these two arguments of this gamma function involve both of them. And here is the theorem which I would like to finish with is the following. If you define this particular combination now of those gamma R functions, again, 12 gamma functions of this type now modified, and two gamma functions of this type in the denominator, there are some properties. You impose on the parameters this condition. This is the balancing condition. Now we have not only continuous but also discrete path. You have to restrict these additional three variables. Epsilon is a special variable which takes 0 and 1 values. It's no time to explain, but it's related to these objects. It's some freedom which emerges in these things. And the theorem states as goes as follows. Again, so these CM functions, these are integrals of those kernels. So essentially, this is an elliptic hypergeometric integral. Because this delta function actually, I mentioned that you come down to the standard elliptic gamma function with the standard arguments p in the power r and q in the power r. The point is that this delta function, it satisfies the following equation. This equation. It's a linear, in this case, p difference equation with the particular coefficient, which is a elliptic function of high order. So essentially, this is the kernel, again, of the integral, which satisfies linear p-difference equation with the partial coefficients. It's by definition, any integral of this thing is the hypergeometric integral. And that's exactly what emerges here as a coefficient in this theorem. So what you have, that's separate, here it is, yeah. So you define coefficients which are integrals, these are the hypergeometric integrals. The point is that you sum up them with respect to this discrete orbit, which is this in the length space, over m additional discrete points, and the sum of these integrals gives you again the product of rarefied elliptic gamma functions. Basically, I would like to stop here. For epsilon equals to zero, it was done by Andrew Kells, and what I managed to do is to show that it's actually more richer, and you have additional degree of freedom this epsilon, and it can take two values, zero and one. But it's very important because the most interesting thing happens exactly for epsilon to equal to one. I will skip. I have more. For instance, elliptic analog of the Zellberg integral has been found long time ago with Van Dijen and myself. And then now I have an analog of that integral, which is extension. At the bottom it has a standard Zellberg integral, which is multivariable analog of the Bethe integral. It's here. I will skip. I don't want to talk about that. I have. Elliptic analog of the analog of the Euler Gauss, of course, and I have analog of this WE7 symmetry acting on this null function. That's probably I should mention this. How is deformed this E7 activities? Yes, this is now this rarefied analog of the Euler Gauss geometric function, and again there is symmetry, so that you have to now do flip both continuous and discrete variables. And the flip is rather interesting. The continuous variable is standard E7, but with the discrete, it's deformation of E7. Because you work with the lattices, you have to try to find transformation which puts one point of the discrete lattice on another point of the discrete lattice. And it's not trivial task. You know, to be able to do it through this wire loop symmetry, you have to do some additional shifts, and they are merging here. And Sergei was asking about the Rahman integral many times. It shows up here in the special t goes to zero limit. And if you put epsilon equal to zero, here it is. This is the Rahman integral which you were asking about. But if you take epsilon to one and you take the same limit in particular choice of discrete variables, you come up with the following hypergeometric identities. They are similar in sense to this Rahman integral formula, but you have now more. You have integer parameter r. And surprisingly, this is a new class of Q identities. And it was missed because you have asymmetry. Symmetries are broken. And it's exactly computable again integral. And it generates a new class of Q hypergeometric identities, which are not, for instance, in the Gasparov-Rahman group at all. It's something new. And the length space emerges here through the addition of this particular integer parameter R. So there is a limit, of course, to downstairs to this differential some type of things.
So this gives equivalence of 4D to you, right?
Yes, it's again, if you talk about the equivalence of field theories, then it's the duality between two field theories. But now instead of this Hopf surface, you have this replacement of the S3 part by the length space.
But it's possible to compactify it to 2D in some way?
No compactification at all. It's a completely four-dimensional theory. The point is that you work in the topological sector, the sector of the PS states. That's where from, in a sense, the dimensionality emerges in the equation. But the original theory is four-dimensional. That's it.